CLL, I think, has a very bad connotation because everybody goes, well, I have CLL to chronic cancer, I can't be cured. And I always say to patients, but it's a cancer that you can live with. It's almost like a chronic other, you know, another medical problem that's chronic, high blood pressure, diabetes.
Well, I think probably that there's a lot of optimism. I think patients who are over 65 right now, even if they need treatment, their life expectancy is probably not shortened by their CLL diagnosis. They may need treatment, they may need to have their disease managed, but we are very effective at managing treatments.
In addition to being hopeful, I think that it's a reality too, right? So hopeful suggests that someday, right, someday we'll make an improvement. But we've made that improvement in CLL. And I think that CLL is really one of those success stories in the last 10 years.
We're very fortunate, both as investigators, but also I think patients are very fortunate too. We've come a long way. You know, I started in leukemia when the only thing we had was chemoimmunotherapy. In fact, I was part of some of those initial fludarabine, cyclophosphamide, rituximab, or FCR trials. And, you know, we've come a really long way. Obviously, in the last 10 years, we've had an explosion of new drugs, of targeted therapies. And so the field has moved very quickly. And I think the patients are now benefiting from a time of enjoyment where they're seeing that we're making advances that are much quicker than we had a long time ago. And they're benefiting from treatments that are improving not only the efficacy, the side effect profile, and survival. And this is like huge, you know, and hopefully, you know, we have lots of new trials that are ongoing that are even looking at not only how to use the existing therapies and how to best use them, but also looking at new targets and newer therapies that hopefully will continue to push the bar. So I think it's a really great time. I mean, you know, obviously, you know, it is stressful for a patient to have this condition. But I think that, you know, we're doing so much and so many things to look forward to, so many things to be hopeful about. That patients really should, you know, everybody should just go, okay, I can do this, we can do this, because the field is moving in a way that is much more positive and much more beneficial. And we all want to say we're going to cure this disease, and hopefully that will happen during my lifetime. But certainly there's no doubt that we're improving survival greatly, that it's approaching the normal survival of patients without this disease. We're getting there. We're getting closer. We're narrowing that gap. And it's truly a chronic disease in that sense until we find a cure. And so, you know, there are going to be periods where patients may need treatment, but there are going to be hopefully be periods of times when patients are off therapy and really are enjoying their life. So I think there's a lot to be hopeful for. In the United States, I think we're blessed by having many different options. But there's no doubt that chemoimmunotherapy may still be an important role in people who live in other countries because they may not have access to drugs. So I don't want to completely bash chemoimmunotherapy. And since I've, again, old enough to be part of that era, you know, there were very many successes of, you know, treatment options such as FCR. In fact, I still have patients who were on those original studies that I haven't retreated. And so they just have a lot more toxicity and we've moved away from it. But, you know, so again, depending upon where you are, you might still need chemoimmunotherapy if you're in a different part of the world that may not have access to some of these new therapies. In the United States, I think we're blessed enough that we've tended to have access to most of these newer therapies. And so many of the patients are really not, because of the data that's been generated, a lot of these phase three studies against chemoimmunotherapy really have shown that people do better on these targeted therapies and there's less side effects to them compared to the traditional chemoimmunotherapy approaches. So we've just moved away from, you know, giving chemoimmunotherapy predominantly in the United States. That being said, you know, when we've looked at, and we don't have a lot of this data, you know, we have a lot of good data, right, going from chemoimmunotherapy to targeted therapies, whether it be with a BTK inhibitor and then venetoclax or a ven-based therapy. You know, I think what patients need to know is that there's always a lot of, I look at clinical trials in many different ways. One is to take agents that we have that are approved that we're tweaking, to looking at different combinations.
Right now, there are three approved continuous therapies for the treatment of CLL. That's ibrutinib, zanubrutinib, and acalabrutinib. And there's one approved time-limited therapy, and that's venetoclax plus obinutuzumab. And the time-limited therapy is given for 1 year, but the continuous therapies you have to take for your life, basically. And the question is, which of those treatment regimens work better and which patients do they work the best in? And we need to figure out that question. Because even though the continuous therapies are very well tolerated, usually our patients can take these pills, enjoy their life, go do the things that they like to do with their family, work, everything. It's still a pill that they have to take, you know, once or twice a day and can lead to toxicity over time. And the venetoclax plus obinutuzumab, the time limit therapy, does require a little bit more upfront monitoring in the first 2 months, which can be disruptive to patients' lives, especially if they're, you know, busy working. And so we don't know which one of these treatment paradigms work better. So one of the trials that is currently enrolling patients in Europe is the CLL17 study. And that's going to compare continuous therapy with ibrutinib versus time-limited therapy with venetoclax plus obinutuzumab plus time-limited therapy with ibrutinib plus venetoclax, which now we're looking to see if these two drugs are combined, do they lead to better outcomes? I think that all of us in the United States were hoping that it would be approved, the combination of ibrutinib plus venetoclax, based off of this phase 3 trial, because it would provide a all-oral regimen as opposed to the venetoclax plus obinutuzumab, which is an oral and an infusion. So it would have been a nice time-limited all-oral regimen that we could have given for our patients. Why it wasn't approved in the United States, from my understanding, is that the FDA were concerned with the toxicity of the combination. So whereas it did prove to be more efficacious than chemoimmunotherapy, which we all knew was going to happen, it was the toxicity component of the ibrutinib plus venetoclax. And so why it was approved in Europe versus the FDA, I think that it's more of a regulatory question and something that we need to, it's more of a regulatory question, and like I don't have the exact answer, but it was toxicity was the main reason, as far as I know. In terms of clinical trials that I'm excited about that I think may change the way we treat CLL, I think there are two therapies that are currently in the FDA approval pipeline. Those therapies are pirtobrutinib and lysocabtagene maraleucel. Big mouthful there. That's Lysocell or Breyanzi. It's a CAR T cell therapy. So I'm really excited about these two therapies coming and being available for our patients. So pirtobrutinib is likely to be approved based off the phase 2 Bruin study, which was a single arm study of pirtobrutinib in relapsed refractory non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. It included about 250 patients with CLL, and those patients all received, or most of those patients received, BTK inhibitor. And this drug, pirtobrutinib, which works similarly but not the same as those original drugs I talked about, the ibrutinib, acalabrutinib, and zanubrutinib, was effective even in patients who've gotten those drugs and also extremely safe. We weren't seeing as many of the toxicities that we typically see with those other BTK inhibitors. So that's a really nice option because it's an oral drug that patients can take after they've already received all of our very therapeutic drugs that we already have available. Now, CAR T-cell therapy is an immunotherapy, it's a cellular therapy really, that has really made a lot of headlines in diffuse large B-cell lymphoma. So a lot of my patients have been coming specifically asking for CAR T-cell therapy for CLL for quite some time now. And in fact, the first 3 patients to ever get CAR T-cell therapy were CLL patients. So it's something that we've been waiting for CLL for quite some time.
CAR T-cell has, CAR T-cell is not new. Not approved yet for CLL, but obviously there's lots of new trials that have been going on for CAR T-cell to try to see if we can advance that for patients with CLL. You know, that has done remarkably well. We've learned, I think, because of the approval in acute leukemia and diffuse large cell lymphoma, we've learned how to use and understand the side effects of CAR T-cell better. So hopefully that'll be something that will take an advantage in patients with CLL.
And so Lysocell is likely to be approved based off of the phase two Transcend study. And in that study, once again, the majority of patients had gotten both BTK inhibitors and BCL2 inhibitors. The CAR T cell therapy is given just one time after some chemotherapy. And there were some really good outcomes that were presented at both the ASCO conference and IWCLL, which just happened last week. So we're excited for these two therapies to get approved. Now, both of these therapies are now in randomized phase 3 studies. So going back to that regulatory piece for a hot second, when a drug goes through a phase 2 study, it gets what the FDA calls accelerated approval. This means that they have approval contingent on a phase 3 study that proves that the drug is better than what we're already doing.
The research that we need to do I think in the near future is figuring out how we can make the immune-based treatments like CAR T-cell therapy and the what's called bispecific antibodies better tolerated in our patient population and more effective. We need to figure out how to help the immune system work better with those treatments as a way to develop curative treatment for our patients. Well, they are treatments that do have some toxicities associated with them. They require sort of the CAR T, for example, requires sort of a center of excellence to manage patients with that therapy. I think as we learn how to use it more effectively and we improve on the tolerability of it, it will be more broadly applicable for our patients. So
then there's newer targets, bispecific monoclonal antibodies, BTK degraders. There's a whole bunch of other new targets that are very young. That are being evaluated in multiply relapse, so patients who have failed covalent BTK inhibitors and venetoclax-based therapies or even chemoimmunotherapy, right? So there are patients that their journey of CLL is very long, hopefully, continues to be very long, and they can go from one agent to another agent to another agent, and you know they're going to need other therapies. And so these are newer trials looking at you know novel agents, different mechanisms of actions to see whether or not they'll be efficacious in patients with CLL. Some of them, I think we're really looking forward to seeing maturing data at the upcoming ASH meeting. So stay tuned. There are upcoming meetings where some of this data, again, still young with some of these drugs, and some of them might work better in combinations with other therapies. So, you know, we're always looking to sort of tweak agents that we might find that might have promise, but maybe they don't have promise just as a single agent. We'll start combining them. So again, field moving very rapidly, new targets being evaluated all the time, so stay tuned. Obviously, there's a move to time-limited approaches to get people off of therapy, to limit their toxicity so they're not on a chronic continuous drug. So I think there's a move in the field away from chronic continuous therapy, albeit we know that from the initial ibrutinib studies. I remember, ibrutinib was approved in 2013. That's 10 years ago. Think about that. That we've had these agents, there's very good data from some of those patients who have been on long-term ibrutinib who are doing well. So I think there's always a potential of some, you know, patients being able to choose a continuous therapy if it's easy for them, if that's all they have access to. There's lots of different ways to think about that and personalize people's treatments experience, which I think is very true. But we are looking to sort of time limit, you know, try to give people a break off of therapy and, you know, limit toxicity by doing so. So you'll see a bunch of these doublets, triplets in comparison to chronic continuous therapy. So that's one set of trials, which is a mouthful because there's a lot of them. And then, of course, we're always looking for new targets. We're always looking for new agents. We're always looking to obviously push the bar, obviously try to understand the biology better, find a curative therapy. So there are newer drugs that are being evaluated. I think we're blessed by having more than one choice. But now these conversations about CLL and treatment take a lot longer. So this is a challenge. I mean, I think this is a challenge for anybody, and whether it's CLL or even other medical problems too. You know, the internet is great, but it's very daunting. Dr. Google is ever present. And so, you know, what's important is that, you know, you can get online and there's a lot of things, but then you go, well, how does this apply to me? Or how do I know what the right choice is? And that's where it really is important to sit down with your physician and talk about what the potential options are. I will always say that people should get a second opinion or at least get a person who's an expert in your area to comment because because of the availability of all these options. You know, back in the day when there was just chemoimmunotherapy, there was just chemoimmunotherapy and there weren't many options. Now there are many, many options. And so I just think that you need to sit down with your physician and your provider to say, you know, where you're at in your CLL journey, you know, if you're interested, am I eligible for any clinical trials or what is available? And if they're not available where you currently are, you seek, you know, consultation to where they might be because there might be a good trial that would be very important for you.
One of the things that patients often apologize to me for are asking too many questions. And I always tell my patients, I get nervous when you guys aren't asking questions. And so I agree, you have to be an advocate for yourself. And if you feel any twinge that something is not going right, then you probably need a second opinion. And honestly, even if you think everything's going right, you probably still should get a second opinion. This is your life, right? This is something that you have to take care of. This is you.
patients are doing so much better. So you need to keep that in mind. We want patients to enjoy their life just as they would if they're living with hypertension and diabetes. We want you to enjoy your life, do what you like to do, spend time with family and friends and work and everything you normally do with other chronic medical problems, and know that there are people who are truly, you know, working on your disease and trying to make this better, and hopefully we'll get there.
I just like to remind my patients to, you know, enjoy their life, right? It's really easy to get caught up in the fact that you have cancer, that this is considered a not curable cancer, that you're gonna have to live with this for your entire life, and really get worried every day. And I really wanna encourage everybody that, you know, in CLL, it's really very treatable. Our treatments really are well tolerated. People take these treatments and really live their lives and enjoy their lives. And so I really want to encourage everybody that cancer does not define you, CLL does not define you, and that you really need to find joy in living, because what's the point otherwise, right? And so really just try to enjoy your life as best as you can.
Well, I think probably that there's a lot of optimism. I think patients who are over 65 right now, even if they need treatment, their life expectancy is probably not shortened by their CLL diagnosis. They may need treatment, they may need to have their disease managed, but we are very effective at managing treatments